Thank you very much, Minister. I thank the Minister and members. That concludes this item of business. We move to the next item, which is a statement from Michael Matheson on the development and deployment of carbon capture, utilisation and storage in Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, therefore there should be no interruptions or interventions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary for around 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I want to provide an update to members in light of last week's illogical and disappointing decision by the UK Government not to support one of the most significant parts of Scotland's journey to net zero, the Scottish cluster led by the ACORN CCS project. This is despite a successful bid that the UK Government acknowledged it met their assessment criteria, instead designated it as a reserved cluster. Members will rightly be interested to understand more about what this decision means for Scotland and our response to this UK Government failure. In doing so, it is important to set CCUS in its proper context as a crucial element of Scotland's decarbonisation as we move towards a just transition to net zero. We are rightly proud of our world-leading statutory emission targets, and CCUS, it is anticipated, will play a vital role in helping us to reach these. We have consistently called on the UK Government to deliver on their areas of climate change responsibility. Collaborative action is particularly vital as we approach COP26. While it is encouraging to see proposals in a number of areas, the recent UK net zero strategy does not go far enough. There are a number of areas where we need the UK Government to take more action and to act faster. This includes more support for areas such as renewables and, of course, CCUS. The UK Government decision last week on the Scottish cluster is out of step with their own net zero strategy, which raised the ambition for the amount of carbon captured to be stored in the UK. The strategy more than doubles the ambition for carbon capture set out in the Prime Minister's 10-point plan, and yet there is no corresponding increase in support for the required multiple CCS projects with the capacity to achieve this. Scotland has vast potential for CO2 storage in the North Sea in depleted oil and gas reservoirs. As seen with the ACORN project, repurposing onshore and offshore legacy oil and gas infrastructure offers us rare and cost-effective access to these storage sites. The ACORN project is expected to store over 6 million tonnes of carbon dioxide a year by 2030, approximately 10% of Scotland's current emissions, and up to 20 million tonnes by 2040. On this basis alone, the decision by the UK Government not to award the Scottish Cluster Track 1 status is wholly illogical. It shows a clear lack of ambition and leadership on climate change by the UK Government. In stark contrast, we see the establishment of CCS in Scotland being able to support decarbonisation efforts across the UK and also in other nations. The Scottish Government has long been supportive of CCUS as a means of decarbonising our industry and underpins negative emission technologies as a vital tool in our armoury to achieve Scotland's emission targets. Our 2045 net zero target is based on advice from the Committee on Climate Change, which states, and it described CCUS as a necessity, not an option, and significantly who pointed to Scotland's CO2 storage potential in recommending this date. CCS offers an important transition opportunity for Scotland's mature oil and gas industry. This UK Government decision will materially affect the businesses and communities in the northeast of Scotland that possess existing skills and expertise required to transition to a low-carbon economy, delaying the opportunity to create good green jobs. A just transition must be delivered across all of our communities, including those that have had a dependency on oil and gas. That's why we've announced a £500 million just transition fund for the North East and Moray, and have asked the UK Government to match that ambition, and why we are also going to support those in carbon-intensive industries with a skills guarantee. Now, I'm aware that some members in this chamber may have concerns over CCUS. Let me reassure those members that I'm aware of those concerns and that this Government's support for this technology is contingent on its performance and consistency with our climate targets. As the First Minister set out in her pre-COP keynote speech yesterday, CCUS, with the highest possible capture rates, could be a crucial technology for industrial decarbonisation and our energy transition, creating options and providing industry with the flexibility to transition their products and services to net zero. It would mean that we can drastically reduce emissions whilst providing security in our energy supply and provide industry with early options to decarbonise. It would ensure a future for Scotland's industrial cluster in Grangemouth and in the North East, ensuring that important domestic industries continue significant employment within a net zero Scotland. Mr. Officer, I wish to reiterate the Scottish Government's support for the Scottish cluster. We have long supported the Acorn project, providing funding and policy support through feasibility stages since 2017, and continue to believe that Acorn is the most cost-effective and deliverable CCS project in the UK. The Scottish cluster estimates its projects can support an average of 15,100 jobs between 2022 and 2050, with a peak of 20,600 jobs in 2031. The UK Government's confirmation that two English industrial clusters would be awarded Track 1 status, overlooking the compelling case submitted by the Scottish cluster, is not just short-sighted, but a serious mistake. We engaged with the UK Government throughout this process to highlight the Scottish cluster's role as a vital component of decarbonisation, both in Scotland and throughout the UK. We also offered the UK Government help in supporting the project on several occasions. Despite the Scottish cluster being considered by most as the most advanced CCS project in the UK, it was not awarded clear, definitive Track 1 status. Instead, a reserve cluster, for what we can only assume to be for political rather than for policy reasons. It is astonishing that the UK Government has taken this decision, which significantly compromises our ability to take crucial near-time action to reduce emissions, not just in Scotland, but right across the UK. The Chancellor is expected to deliver his budget on Wednesday. He has a chance to fix this in his budget announcement, and I would urge him to do so. Last week, Presiding Officer, Sirreen Wood stated the UK Government's decision makes little economic or environmental sense, and likened their approach to leaving the best player on the subs bench. These are sentiments which I share, and I'm sure many colleagues across the chamber share them too. Presiding Officer, let me be very clear. This Government believes plainly and simply that the UK Government has made a serious mistake which it needs to correct and to award the Scottish cluster Track 1 status. The Scottish cluster presents the best opportunity to reduce emissions by the mid-2020s. Not to recognise that smacks of politics, not science. This inexplicable decision shows the UK Government are guilty of empty words and broken promises of ensuring a just transition for Scotland's communities. Remember, the UK Government pulled the plug on £1 billion of carbon capture investment for Peterhead in 2015, and now they're repeating the same trick again. The northeast of Scotland is a home of the offshore industry and an obvious location for a carbon capture project. I therefore call today upon the UK Government to reverse this decision and accelerate the Scottish cluster to full Track 1 status without delay. We have previously advised the UK Government that we would help to support the Scottish cluster, and we stand ready to do so. But we do not hold all of the necessary legislative or regulatory levers which are retained by the UK Government. Earlier today, the Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work and I met with the cluster representatives, reaffirming that we are continuing to support CCS in Scotland and outlined our call to the UK Government. I can also confirm that the First Minister will be writing to the Prime Minister to make the strong case for the acceleration of the cluster to Track 1 in the coming days. President Officer, CCUS will play an essential role in industrial decarbonisation in Scotland and worldwide. The planned Scottish cluster will play a vital role in a just transition, ensuring that Scotland reaches its net zero goal by 2045. The Scottish Government will continue to press for Track 1 status for the Scottish cluster and to support the development and deployment of CCUS in Scotland that is compatible with our climate change targets.
Thank you, Mr Matheson. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow, again, around 20 minutes for questions. I would encourage members who wish to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function. Let's start with Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. We are all disappointed by this decision, but let's be clear. Far from being illogical or indeed inexplicable, this was an objective process based on objective criteria, which the Scottish Government didn't raise any issues about, and it was judged against which of the bids hit those criteria. And let's be also clear, this is not the end of Acorn, but the beginning of an ambition to have four clusters running by 2030. And Kwasi Kwarteng says Acorn will almost certainly be built in the next few years as part of the second phase. And the UK Government continues to work with them to ensure readiness. I say continues because the Cabinet Secretary seems to have conveniently forgotten that the UK has also produced an Energy Right paper, a £16 billion North Sea transition deal, established Aberdeen as an energy transition zone with £27 million worth of support, and already given £31 million in support to Acorn. So let me ask, Cabinet Secretary, the Acorn project partners have stated publicly they intend to maintain the project timeline to be operational by the end of 2026. The UK is committed to support them in this, both financially and with management. What has the Scottish Government officially offered to the cluster to ensure they can proceed by 2026? And secondly, one solution is for the Scottish Government to commit to fund the project. Will it do so? And finally, how much precisely of the proposed Just Transition Fund is earmarked to go towards CCS projects?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, it's interesting that given that Liam Kerr only a few months ago was setting himself up as the champion for the Acorn project with his article in the Press and Journal, he's been quite literally sold down the river by his colleagues in Westminster. Can I gently suggest to Liam Kerr he shouldn't be in this chamber disappointed by his colleagues in Westminster? He should be angry at the way in which they have treated the people of the northeast of Scotland in this decision, not simply disappointed. And I think you should be speaking up a bit more for the people in the northeast of Scotland in demonstrating that. And if it's not illogical to double your target for the use of carbon dioxide storage in the UK in your net zero strategy, but the day before don't support the most cost-effective, largest capacity CCS project in the UK to deliver that, I'm sorry, I don't know what illogical is then, because to me it's very clear there's a lack of consistency in the UK approach, which is why it smacks and smells more of politics rather than science. And I'm afraid the member should be standing up to challenge that. And let me say to the points that the member's made, one of the things that's very clear from the discussion I've had with the cluster members today is that they have got no clarity from the UK Government on what reserve status actually means. It has not been explained to them what support will be available to them. There is no explanation of what funding will be available to them. There is no timeline been set by the UK government on what reserve status means, how long reserve status is meant to last for. What the UK government have done is they have left the project high and dry. But what I can assure the member of is that we are going to work with the cluster to make sure that we keep the pressure on the UK government to stick to the promise and to deliver on the Acorn project in the Scottish cluster, because it's critical not just to Scotland's net zero targets, it's critical to the UK's net zero targets.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. I feel it is regrettable that here we are on the eve of COP26 and we have the UK Government and the Scottish Government at loggerheads when we do need to have constructive dialogue to tackle the climate emergency. Cabinet Secretary, in your statement you have acknowledged that there are concerns about the performance of carbon capture technologies and consistency with climate targets. For example, Friends of the Earth Scotland question whether CCS is falsely positioned as a climate solution when the technology is largely unproven and untested. So I just wonder what the Scottish Government is doing to unpick those concerns and allay those fears. And can the Cabinet Secretary give assurance that these technologies are not being seen as a silver bullet and that other measures which can help in the short term, including improved access to public transport and improving energy efficiency, will be continued at pace?
Cabinet Secretary.
Look, Presiding Officer, if there's a failure in this process on the eve of COP26 to take the serious action that's necessary to tackle climate change, I'm afraid that responsibility rests at the door of 10 Downing Street in failing to provide the support to the Scottish cluster. Because from Grangemouth right up to the St Fergus terminal, it is critical not just to helping to support that we achieve our net zero targets, but to a whole range of industries that are supporting it in order to help to decarbonise their industrial processes. It is mission critical to many of them in being able to deliver that. And it's critical to the jobs that are dependent on it as well. So I'm afraid the issue about loggerheads and the responsibility for this issue rests fairly and squarely with the UK government. And I can assure the member that there are those who raise questions about it, but as we take advice from the Committee on Climate Change in these matters, they've said that the use of CCS is, as I said in my statement, a necessity, not an option. It's a technology which is in its infancy, but it has got the real potential to deliver real change. And that's why we're also very clear that the deployment of net zero technology of this nature has to be compatible with achieving our net zero targets by 2045. And that's exactly what our commitment is, and it's why we support the Acorn project and why it's so important to making sure that we reach our statutory targets.
Gillian Martin, to be followed by Brian Whitton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The decision not to back the Acorn project is another betrayal of the North East of Scotland by the Tories, who previously cut the £1 billion of funding for the carbon capture scheme at Peterhead after a huge amount of progress and investment. And as you've just said, the Committee on Climate Change specifically said that CCUS is essential to us being able to meet the targets that we're put forward in the Climate Change Act. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Acorn project was the obvious project to give support to, that failure to do so is an absolutely political decision, the UK government is yet again holding Scotland's progress back, and that we cannot rely on this UK government to ever stand up for Scotland's interests?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, officer, there's absolutely no doubt to those, and I spoke to many across the industry over recent months, that the Acorn project was viewed, and the Scottish cluster in particular, was viewed as being the most deliverable, cost-effective, ready-to-go project when it came to delivering on CCUS. It was the clear project. It's not just a project that is able to deliver at an early stage in the mid-2020s. It's also a project which, and I don't decry the other two projects because I think we need them alongside the Scottish cluster as well, but it's the only project that had the ability to allow the shipment of carbon dioxide, which was planned to support areas such as the south of Wales and other parts of the south of England where industries are looking to decarbonise and they wanted to use the Scottish cluster as part of that process, and Acorn project in particular. So it's a project that supports not just Scottish jobs, but jobs well beyond Scotland in other parts of England. And it was mission critical to supporting them in doing that. And I am angry that we are in a situation where the UK government has let down a sector despite their significant work in this particular project, and giving them the impression that the project was going to get the green light, to have pulled the rug from under their feet at the very last moment. The repercussions of that are significant, and it is important that the UK government recognise the implications this has got for the sector, not just in the North East and other parts of Scotland, but for other parts of the UK, and that they revisit this matter, and they revisit it urgently.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm keen to get through all the questions, so I would ask questioners the Cabinet Secretary to be as brief as they can. Next, it's Brian Whittle, who joins us remotely, and then Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Glaikin said at the weekend that the SNP's petulant manufactured row with the Westminster Government over Freeports may have contributed to this decision, and that the SNP would create similar obstacles should Acorn have won. Now, obviously, we know that it was actually done on objective criteria, but the SNP's grievance approach and continual desire to create discord is well known. Will the Scottish Government now work constructively with the Westminster Government to ensure that Acorn receives the appropriate support to proceed from both governments as soon as possible to the benefit of the environment and the Scottish economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
So there we have it, Presiding Officer, from Brian Whittle. Manufactured reasons as to why the UK Government chose not to go ahead with Acorn around Freeports. Utter rubbish, and there is no truth in it whatsoever, and it should be treated with the contempt with which it deserves. What I can say to Mr Whittle is that on several occasions we made a direct offer to the UK Government to provide support to the project, and to date I'm still waiting for a response from the UK Government to my correspondence on that very matter. Sadly, they don't appear to have chosen to prioritise it, and clearly, given their decision last week, they've chosen just not to go ahead with the project, end of. But what you can be assured of, Mr Whittle, is that we'll continue to push the case for the Scottish cluster and to make sure that the UK Government hear the voices of the people of Scotland on this very important issue.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish business leaders, including Sir Ian Wood, have written to the Prime Minister, arguing that the Scottish cluster offers the potential to create, safeguard and continue to support tens of thousands of highly skilled jobs, both directly and in the supply chain of the existing energy industry in the North East, as well as throughout Scotland. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK Government should listen to those voices and not just ignore them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much welcome the letter that has gone from Sir Ian Wood and a number of others calling on the Prime Minister to address this issue. It's an issue which I've discussed in recent months with Sir Ian Wood, the importance of the Acorn project and the Scottish cluster. Given his expertise and knowledge in this area, he sees it as being mission critical to the future of North Sea oil and gas and to the transition within the sector. I think it would be fair to say the general feedback which I've had from within the sector is one of shock, as some put it, flabbergasted at the decision by the UK Government. So it is important that the UK Government listen to this, the voices of reason from people like Sir Ian Wood, and that they respond to that constructively and that they reverse this decision quickly.
Michael Mara, to be followed by Audrey Nicholls.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I sincerely hope that the COP delegations are not taking diplomacy and negotiation lessons from the Minister, or frankly from some of the representatives opposite. There was no answer from the Minister on whether the Scottish Government would act to support this project themselves. We must work together in that case, and this Government has a duty to make this sector work by whatever means. So can I ask the Minister what progress has been made in investing in skills base in the north-east of Scotland to ensure that the region is at the forefront of a jobs-first energy transition?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can say to the Member is that we have provided support over the last couple of years to the Acorn project as it moves through its feasibility programme of work in supporting it and carrying out that work, given the importance of it. Secondly, we have already made a clear commitment to supporting the deployment of carbon capture, utilisation and storage in Scotland as part of our Energy Emerging Technologies Fund, which we remain committed to doing over the coming years. Part of how much of that we can support is dependent upon the decision by the UK government, because a key part of this is tied up in regulations and powers which the UK government have, which we don't have the powers to intervene in. But there may be other areas around the project which we can continue to provide support and assistance to, and we are actively considering that. However, what I would say to remember is that I don't think now is a time for us to start unpicking elements of the Scottish cluster. What is important here is that we point out to the UK government their failure and the serious mistake which they have made, and they need to address that urgently because of the potential consequences. And on the member's final point, I can assure the member one of the key actions that we want to see coming through our North-East and Moray transition deal is helping to support that skills transition, assisting those who are in carbon-intensive industries moving into zero-carbon industries. And that will be a key focus of both the training and the work that will go forward as part of the North-East transition deal.
Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP Scottish Government has committed to investing £500 million in the North East and Moray over the next 10 years to accelerate the transition to net zero and support highly skilled jobs and livelihoods in the oil and gas sector. If the UK Government are serious about a just transition for the North East, does the Cabinet Secretary think they should match this funding commitment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, yes, I think they do. They should. We've asked them to do so. I think they should match that, given the economic benefits that the UK has obtained from oil and gas extraction over many decades on the back of Scotland's resources and the northeast of Scotland in particular. And it's about time that they stepped up and they helped to support that transition. So matching us in that £500 million transition fund for the northeast and Moray, alongside going ahead with the Scottish cluster in Tier 1, would be a step in the right direction in demonstrating that leadership from the UK Government.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Karen Adam.
After years and years of delay, during which carbon capture was on, then off, and then on again, the biggest loser, I have to say, has been the planet. I will support the government's call for this decision to be reversed, but does the minister agree with me that what's most important is that this project actually happens this time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do agree it is. We've already had a false dawn. And with all due respect to the member, I think it was Ed Davey who made that promise during the referendum campaign, which was very short-lived after the referendum result. And I think that's why this time we cannot allow the UK government to get away with pulling the same trick yet again on the people of North East and the people of Scotland. And I welcome the support of the member in getting behind us in making sure that we do everything we can to pressurise the UK government to reverse the decision and to put the Scottish cluster in track one.
Karen Adam to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The triple whammy of a downturn in oil and gas, COVID and Brexit have been devastating for our North East communities. We desperately needed this investment, which would have been based in my constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast. It would have helped to deliver that just transition. The Scottish Conservatives have described this move by the UK Government as a lukewarm disappointing. My constituents are not disappointed. They're feeling betrayed, angry and overlooked once again. Will the Cabinet Secretary join me in urging Conservative MSPs in this chamber, particularly those who represent the North East, to stand up for their constituents and urge their colleagues in the UK Government to reverse this decision and support this vital project?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I think one of the things that we need to recognise here, and the desire I understand from Conservative members to try and give the impression that those everything's going to be okay with the Acorn project and the Scottish cluster, is that just give it time. The problem with that approach is that there are very significant investment decisions that have to be made by companies on where they are going to support the development of CCS technology. And those decisions are being made now, not 2, 3, 4, 5 years' time or an indefinite time frame as reserve status provides, because there's a lack of clarity around this for the whole of the cluster. So it's important that we don't allow what is the fundamentals of this project to be lost because of their importance. and I hope that members on the Conservative benches will get behind us in supporting this and will put as much pressure on their colleagues at Westminster to reverse this decision.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We've got three more questioners. I intend to allow all of them in, but the questions will need to be brief and so will the responses. Firstly, Mark Ruskell, who joins us remotely.
The Cabinet Secretary is aware that our parties do not have a shared vision for the role of CCS, and the technology is repeatedly overpromised and underdelivered around the world. Relying on it to cut a quarter of Scotland's emissions is risky, and all the parties in the last Parliament agreed that there needs to be a plan B developed to meet our climate targets and deliver a just transition without a reliance on CCS. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does he recognise the importance of working out that plan B now, rather than pinning all of our hopes on a technology that may turn out to neither be credible or ready in time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the advice we have from the Committee on Climate Change is the important role that zero emission technologies will play in helping to meet our statutory climate targets, and it's one of the things that they have directly referenced. I respect the fact that we have a difference of view on the use and deployment of CCUS. The Scottish Government is supportive of it and continues to be supportive of it, including the Scottish Cluster and the ACORN project, and will continue to be so going forward. I think we have to recognise that it will play and is likely to play an important part in meeting Scotland's statutory climate targets. And that's the approach that we are going to continue to take moving forward. And it's important that we recognise the role that this technology will have to play in helping to support us in becoming a net zero nation by 2045.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Earlier this year, Stuart Hazeldine, a Professor of Carbon Capture and Storage at the University of Edinburgh, gave evidence at the Economy Committee. In response to being asked what was needed to make CCS a success, he said, and I quote, "In Scotland, we do not have a clear industrial roadmap for the circularity of our heat or carbon and for putting that back where it came from. So will the Cabinet Secretary agree to develop a clear industrial roadmap for Scotland?"
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I think let's not lose sight of the critical issue here, and that is the development of CCUS technology. One of the benefits you have with the ACORN project in the Scottish Cluster is the benefits of being first mover in some of the development of this technology and how it can then be utilised and deployed in different areas from that for which it was originally developed. And that's why this project is so important, to help to develop that route map, to help to create the opportunity that this new technology can develop in a number of different areas and how it can be utilised to help to meet our statutory climate change targets. So I can assure the member that our support for ACORN and CCUS is to make sure that we get the benefits of the development of the technology and how that can be deployed in a number of different sectors, not just in oil and gas.
And finally, Fiona Hislop. It may have been my fault for not pre-announcing you, Ms. Hislop. There we go.
Thank you very much. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the advanced stage and capability of the ACORN project would and should not only underpin the just transition needed in the northeast of Scotland, but could and should be the quickest, fastest way of sharing that knowledge and deployment on a global stage so that the world can move more quickly to decarbonise, such has been the global interest over the last decade and previously in the work in Scotland? Does he think the UK government just doesn't care about its responsibilities to the North East?
As briefly as possible, please, Cabinet Secretary.
There is absolutely no doubt the Scottish Cluster is a key part to delivering a just transition. We've saw the failures of UK governments in the past with deindustrialisation and not ensuring a just transition, and we can't allow that mistake to be repeated again, particularly in the northeast of Scotland. But there's no doubt one of the benefits of moving early with this project, giving its ability to move at an early stage, is the knowledge and skills it builds up, which can then be exported and deployed in other parts of the world, supporting other nations in being able to become a net zero nation.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. There'll be a slight break before we start the next item of business.